This program and its contents are designed for information and educational purposes only. This program does not render medical advice or professional services and is not intended to be a substitute for professional care. The information provided here should not be used for the purposes of diagnosing or treating a medical or psychiatric condition. If you have or suspect you may have a health problem, consult your healthcare provider.
Hi, welcome to Positive Momentum TV. I'm Diane Silva, and today my guest is Chris Silva, my husband, our director, and all-around really nice guy. Anyway, we're getting ready to launch our aviation and travel series, and as we've talked before, I've experienced travel anxiety, and I've overcome much of it. However, one of the things we wanted to share is the processes we go through, the support side of things, different steps we all can take to kind of help each other, you know, have the life we want and what we dream of, doing what we dream of doing. So with that, Chris, let's kind of touch on, kind of give me a little bit of your experience or at least your role in all of this and a little backstory.
Going back a little bit, actually, you know, prior to us being married, there's things that I saw in you where you were always busy, and one of those things was what attracted me towards you. What I found out after we got married and started doing some traveling together was that some of those things that you did was actually things, coping mechanisms that you did to kind of avoid travel, whether it was flying or driving, and you know, found out really the one trip that we had scheduled that was, I believe, going to Denver, where you weren't able to make it on the plane. Mm-hmm. And that's when I became fully aware of that you struggled a lot with anxiety about flying. So.
Well, yeah, I mean, as we found out later, it wasn't just flying, it was travel. Right. Well, it didn't matter the mode of transportation. There was an anxiety, usually anticipatory anxiety involved. So if we could back up, let's go when we first encounter the anxiety. I know when I first feel it, but when do you first notice it? As being the support, I really kind of want to focus on that because there is a lot of focus on people who are anxious. And then we're going to also touch on how to deal with, you know, this side as well as, you know, pointers from the support side. So.
Well, it's been a learning process. Okay. And part of it is that what we went through before and what I've learned since then, I handle things differently now than I did before. So before, I really didn't know how to handle it and kind of fumbled around. There's things I know I did that irritated you, invalidated, you know, your feelings. I, you know, found out that I ended up kind of pushing at times to where that just built on your anxiety.
So basically, can we gonna just kind of do a real quick recap of the don'ts? What not to do to people who are in the, and it's, this is when they're experiencing anxiety. You know, once they're out of that moment, then it's time to talk. But while somebody's in an anxiety attack, what do you not do? Okay. Let's kind of start there.
Well, we can do that. Yeah. What I have learned is when a person is in an anxious moment, is you do not try and rationalize. Number one is do not try and rationalize things to that person. What I've found out is that you do need to allow that person to get through the emotional part of it. And from there, once you see things start to calm down a little bit, you can kind of watch either by body language or voice and tone, you know, the tone of your voice. But just bottom line is kind of follow your lead to determine what to do. So first thing is not try and rationalize. Number two is don't push. Don't try and explain things. You don't give them space. you know.
You don't give them space, or you
do? No, you do give them space.
Okay, sorry.
You do give them space. Sorry. Okay. You do want to give them space and allow them to be able to, as we have learned, go from the emotional mind to the rational mind. And once you start to go to the rational mind, then you can, on your own, figure out, okay, this is what's really causing this. You know, why are you reacting the way you're doing? Why are you feeling the way you are? So those are just basically, first and foremost, is stepping back and just watching, you know, observing, listening, that type of thing.
So basically, I would like to kind of, if you don't mind, I add to that. You know, it's like you, like you said, you step back, but you're not so far away that that person feels alone.
Right.
But it's close enough, and it's got to be a dance, you know. It's this, am I too close, am I not close enough? And you really follow that person's lead. And trust me when I say, we're not doing this on purpose. We are as much torment, if not more, than the person who's trying to support us, because we're trying to deal with our stuff as well as trying not to hurt anybody else and trying to accommodate what they're thinking and what they're needing. You know, so we're kind of caught in this. And that's where the loop keeps going. So if we know you're taken care of and, you know, we're not having to appease you, we can kind of go back inside and say, okay, wait a minute, let's breathe. Okay, mm-hmm. we're okay right now. I'm okay right now. And we can focus on and just kind of be in the moment, which brings us quicker. And don't try to resist this, because the more, it's like with being in labor, the more you fight it, the harder it is. So if you just kind of, all right, this sucks, but I'm here, you know, okay, it'll be over. 90 seconds, it's done, as long as we don't recreating this loop, from what I understand.
Yeah.
And it's working, really helping these, you know, helping ourselves as well as trying to help the people who are supporting us support us.
Right. To your point is, in observing, is also wanting to give the person space, as you said, but not too much space. So you still want to show that you're there for them. You know, and that is, it is a balancing act to,
yeah.
You know, because there's times where you have wanted just to go to another room or take a drive or whatever, is to allow the person to do that. Other times you want me still in the same room, but just maybe you need to vent. You know, it's, certain things work at one mm-hmm. time, they may not work at another time. So you just got to kind of go through your series of things that you try to help, and sometimes you get a little beat up on the way.
And this is no excuse to beat anybody up. Seriously,
no, you know, it's not intentional.
You know, it's not intentional. You know, we're. I can't explain how apologetic and how horrible we feel. I feel afterwards. You know, it's. I don't know how to process this. I don't know what to do. I'm stuck in this emotional, terrorizing place that, you know, and it's a obsessive compulsive thought that just keeps going and building, and it's you know, so it takes a team and one heck of a toolbox to be able to get yourself to the point where, you know, this anxiety is no longer excuse me, controlling you, and you're trying to get that monster down instead of being, you know, David dealing with Goliath. You know, you try to bring Goliath down at least to your level.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where you need a team. And that's where the support comes in, of not just the people who you care about. So we have to also help take care of our support.
Yeah. Well, at the moment you can't, because you're mm-hmm. dealing with
right.
the anxiety that you're dealing with. But one thing that you said that I do believe, strongly believe in, is the fact that you do need a toolbox that you learn and that you use and put into place of different things, because just as much as being a support person, that I have to go through different things and try different things. You know, for yourself, for your toolbox, there's things where you need, you know, sometimes you can try something and it works. Other times it doesn't work. So one of the things that is probably the first step for you that I see is being aware of what you are doing. Because there's been a lot of times as we've gone through many cycles of this, you know, going through trips and that type of thing, mm-hmm. Where when you've gotten to the point of being aware of what you're doing or aware how you're feeling or aware of all that kind of stuff, you're able to change things or, I don't want to say change your behaviors, but
tone it down some anyway.
It kind of takes you off the ledge quicker.
Okay.
When you're aware of it.
Awareness.
I mean,
that's
that's what I've have observed, to where your mood can just change, and I can see it in your facial expressions, in your tone of voice, your body movements. So there's many times that will shorten the length of the anxious moment quite a bit when you're aware of it quicker.
Well, so that. I almost feel certifiable sometimes.
Really.
You know, well, you know, it is how it is, you know. And that's the horrible part of anxiety. It's not just what's going on internally. Mm-hmm. It's what we have our family and loved ones go through, and what we're worried about other people, what their perceptions are, you know, and then sometimes you tell, you know, it's a, you can take the wind out of the sails of anxiety by telling somebody, hey, I'm having an anxious moment. And then there's people say, oh, don't worry about it. Well, you know, you just told a two-year-old that there's no monster under the bed instead of handing them the flashlight and saying, let's go figure out how you can get rid of that monster.
Right.
You know, so, you know.
But one of the things that really, it's kind of like what they say on the airplane is the fact that You keep saying about you're worried about other people.
Well, we are.
Well, I understand. I understand you are worried about it. But at the same time, as they say on the airplane, is you got to put on your mask first. In other words, you got to take care of yourself first, and everything else is going to fall into place. Then you can help other people. So the sooner, to me, that mask is your awareness.
Right.
And the sooner you get to that point, then the sooner you can help.
Right, but that goes the same for you as support and anyone mm-hmm. else who's supporting. You know, sometimes you say you get beat up or you feel beat up. And in some
sometimes,
ways,
yeah.
it's not literal. It's, you know, verbal or, you know, there's the
emotional.
It wears you down.
It
wears you down. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, we're caretakers for someone with Alzheimer's, and it is wearing. So, you know, we got that on top of. But the point is, you've got to take care of yourself. And if you have to step away, you have to step away. You
mm-hmm.
know, that person will survive this. An anxiety attack will not kill you. But it doesn't mean you don't feel like it's not going to at the moment.
Yeah.
You know, that it can be kind of, it's an internal bully, internal terrorist. You
Good
know,
way of
they're
putting
monsters.
It.
They're, you know, I mean, whatever term you want to use, you know, it can be menacing.
Sure.
And trying to figure out tools to be able to stop it from growing and at least bring it down to a manageable level. And once you get it manageable, then, you know, maybe we can work to get it eliminated. I know there's some I have eliminated. I
mm-hmm.
still haven't gotten over some of the flying, which is one of the things we're going to be talking about for the next couple of weeks. And we've got some pilots we've talked to. We've flown, you know, so we've got a lot of stuff coming up for the next couple of weeks. And then Chris and I will be here also for the next couple of weeks discussing different experiences we had, how to take care of each other.